How is everybody doing today? Are we ready for Big Art Quest Tree Clinic? No, I don't even have the number down yet because I got to go look that up. It's been kind of a crazy week. But don't worry, the Big Art Quest Tree Clinic really is. We're going to break it down. Trees, branches, trunks, types of trees. What's going on with all these trees? How you doing today? John.
Good. How are you doing?
I am doing really good.
Yeah?
I am. Yeah. It's been stormy.
It has been.
So stormy. Has it been stormy where you are? I hope you're staying safe and dry wherever you are. Seriously, it's kind of scary out there. Taking care of yourselves.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's quite a thing. If you've never been here before and you just walked in because you're like, I'm curious about trees, I'm going to explain everything you need to know as a new artist about trees to help you be more successful at painting them. The voice that you hear that you may or may not see the face of is my husband, John. He is a sweetheart and he runs a very complicated piece of equipment off camera. So he switches cameras and tracks me all my craziness around, and he reads the chat. I don't actually get to see the chat.
No, we took it away from you.
Because we took it away from me.
But sometimes I show it to you. Sometimes I bring the chat
sometimes
back.
You do, but also now at this point, it's like teeny tiny text I can't read anyway. So it's like, I don't know. It could be something. I don't know. We're
going
to even talk a little bit about bark. So first thing you want to say is trees are hard for people.
Yeah.
Trees are hard. Not that they're actually any harder. Nothing is actually any harder to paint than anything else in art. It's psychological. Like all the time I'm like, I'm not good at cars. It's a psychological problem. I'm having a psychological problem about cars. It's not that cars are particularly different to paint than a horse swimming underwater, which is probably feels very challenging to many people. What would that be like to paint? It's just kind of like whatever you've invested your skill and your time into, you get more adept at, and what you don't maybe is more challenging. The thing that happens to new painters about trees, though, is a little bit different. It's a little bit different than anything else that they run into. And I think you've even had this experience, right, John? Doing your little branch with Mom?
Yeah.
It's hard. And what it is that in your life, whereas you might not have looked at a lot of horses, and you might not have really sat and observed a lot of other things that we paint on the show, like foxes or wolves or whatever we're doing, you probably have looked at a lot of trees. Wherever you live in the world, you probably have a tree you love. You have trees that maybe you carved initials into. You read The Giving Tree. You had, you know, trees for the holidays. Who knows what's going on in your world, but I promise you somewhere in your world, wherever you live, there's an important tree. Maybe it's a limon tree. I don't know. Maybe it's an olive tree. Trees are so close to the human heart and experience, and we're so emotional about them, and we have such a mass of information that is both emotional and factual. And then when you add the left brain, oh, thank you, John. When you add the left brain to the circumstance, well, stuff just gets crazy and frustration just builds. And if you've ever had that experience where you're trying to paint this tree, what's actually happening is this beautiful, dynamic, spiritual inner picture of a tree is not matching up to whatever you're physically ready today to paint. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Cool. So I asked John that, like, because he reads your reactions. That's why sometimes I look over at John and go, does that make sense? Because he's reading it going, yeah, no, they know what you're talking about. I'm like, nope, you're missing the mark today.
There's 220 blank screens staring back at you right now going, what are you talking about, Sherpa?
That could happen.
No.
Human peoples can do that to you. That's what the human peoples can do. They can just stare right back at you.
We have a huge community here.
Well, I think a lot of people have a lot of, they want to succeed at trees. And I think before we begin,
yeah,
I want you guys to succeed at trees. That is my goal. So we're going to slow down in a couple areas today from our usual live pace,
mm-hmm,
to really, really, really get into those trees. And then also, I want to, because I know many of you like are very shy and don't want to ask a question and don't want to feel silly. And I cannot stress enough that you cannot ask a silly question. Well, maybe you can. Maybe you can be like, how many monkeys can we fit in a barrel? And that might be a silly question. We might still enjoy it, though. But I mean, like, whatever you're wondering, whatever your challenge is, whatever you've got going on, you know, hey, it's okay to ask. And the first challenge that I'm going to talk about is the canvas challenge. And we're going to start talking about that all the time right now.
What's that?
The white pitting on canvases.
Oh, my gosh.
Who's
that's
had
so
that?
Crazy.
Who's had that?
I think everybody has. I mean, like in the chat, I hear about it all the time. How do we stop the pitting on the canvas?
Okay, so I'm still waiting for a confirmed answer for what exactly, technically, chemically it is, but I believe, this is a belief I have. This is not a fact, it's a belief, it's an opinion.
It's a feeling?
It's like a strong feeling. I feel like the canvases are manufactured all over the world.
Yes.
And they have to ship, and you might not know this, but canvases are very susceptible to mold and other things that can attack them.
And they stick to each other.
And I think that there's a coating on the canvases to prevent the sticking and to prevent the molding that is also preventing the paint.
I wonder if that's like a chemical that could be used on the outside of the finished
product.
I'm
trying not to think about this chemical too much because I bet it's much more exciting than even cadmium. I suspect that nobody's looking at what this is, and you shouldn't even be breathing when you open your canvas packs. I'm not saying that's true. I'm just saying I've been around a while, and
there's probably something brewing here we're not aware of.
Experience tells me. So what I have been doing, what some people have been doing to some success, now I've got canvas paper here, and it's not going to give me any trouble. I don't have any trouble with my canvas papers. I think because where they're manufactured and they're not subject to the same issues that the canvas
like
canvases are.
Yeah, trying to stick them together.
I'm talking about those canvas packs.
Yeah.
Yeah. These I haven't had any trouble with, which is why I'm working on paper today. And I suggest if you're practicing your trees, you might consider getting like a Strathmore canvas pad. It's like it's like a paper that's been given a canvas texture and it kind of has some gesso on it. It's like, I'm faking canvas.
Oh, yeah.
I fake it. It's really awesome stuff. And if you're budget conscious, wow, it can really help you on your painting expenses.
Oh, Can we squeeze in a little happy birthday real quick?
Yeah.
Happy birthday, little brush Raven.
Hi, Raven. Happy birthday.
And Susie.
And Susie?
And Susie. It's
happy birthday, Susie. So, is she a little brush too?
No.
We're all little brushes at heart.
Yeah.
Raven, you know it's true. We all just want to have more fun, right? Yeah. Okay. Thank you guys for coming by today on your birthday. So my wish is that you get a tree breakthrough.
And happy anniversary, Lisa.
Happy anniversary, Lisa. That is real. There's some cool stuff afoot.
Yeah, there's all sorts of lovely stuff going on
there's
in here.
There's some lovely, lovely, lovely stuff afoot. Well, on the canvas is what we've been doing, and I'm going to start mentioning it every class, is either we've been rinsing, like where you just literally take it in your sink and you just kind of spray rinse it off, and then you just let it dry. You don't want to soak it down, and it's just the front, not the back of the canvas. The risk to that is over-tightening the drum. It hasn't really messed with me yet, but I'm just letting you know it has that potential. The other is why I'm holding this brush and waving it around like a crazy person so somebody can make a comment about it later. Here you go. It's a freebie. Have fun.
What is that? What are you doing?
This is just a 1.5-inch flat brush. You could use any house brush.
Oh.
You can take Flow Aid, acrylic flow release. There's a Liquitex, and here's the golden version. I'm just familiar with the golden version. And you mix these up as per the manufacturer's recommendations. Let me tell you, on this stuff, just follow the manufacturer's recommendations, please. So you mix a jug of it up, you put it in your water glass, and then I just brush that on the canvas, right, which does not over-tighten my drum, right, and does also seem to remove whatever chemical it is. Because this is about improving the surface tension and improving the flow of paint. I would use this traditionally in a fine art practice to do staining, which we're going to do sometime.
Interesting.
For fun, for those of you that got flow, acrylic flow, you're like, what else can I do with the flow? I'm going to show you staining later. But until we get to that, it's just a nice thing, and you can get the Liquitex or the golden version of this and do that brush on, which you do not want to do. And it says it on the bottle, but I never trust y'all during the bottle. Just don't put it in a spray bottle. It's tempting. Everybody wants to do it, which is why they put it on all the bottles to not to.
Mm-hmm.
So don't eat paint. Don't spray flow aid. We're don't adding to spray, our list of things to not do. Don't
aerosol spray.
Don't, you know, smoke near your varnish. There's a whole bunch of safety tips.
Read your safety standards. Artwork can have, I mean, you're working with complicated materials here. Varnishes, you know, clear coats, acetones, all of these things have complicated, they're chemicals. So just be aware of them, not that they're intrinsically unsafe if you handle them correctly. And that's why for hundreds of thousands of years, artists have been successfully not killing themselves at art.
Or not falling, you know, playing with the lead paint wrong and having whole moments.
There are some artists who are like, I'm going to try this new experimental thing that nobody knows about. And it kind of goes bad.
Yeah, reading up on Turner. He apparently used to upset the actual creator of Windsor and Newton Paint. Windsor.
Oh, yeah?
Mm-hmm. He used to really just stress him full on out.
Oh.
So, because we've got Turner coming up on Saturday. All right. Oh, okay. So all right. You're probably like, are we ever going to get to the stream? We are. Yep. Hang in with me. So today we're going to look at common mistakes, how to correct for them. We're going to look a little bit at creating trees with palette knives.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to look at different types of tree techniques. This isn't about how to get realistic trees out yet. This is about really exploring some of those silhouette trees and tree shapes and whimsical trees and creepy trees and all kinds of trees that we might want to do in our lives.
Mm-hmm.
To just start that conversation, and then we're probably going to do a follow-up where we work on realistic trees.
Okay.
Right? So, but if you've been like, I think my branches, a good friend of mine likes to say they look like antlers, so let's talk about that first.
Okay.
I'm going to paint a tree that looks like antlers.
Are you?
Yeah, I am. So, let's say, and I'm just going to do this in silhouette right here. Okay. And I'm sure that the camera will follow me, and so I'm going to plant a tree up.
Okay, I'm going to get over there.
One of the things that I've got here is you're going to notice that I have two types of paint that you can do. I've got the carbon black, right? Fluid paint.
Yeah.
This means soft body. Guess what's a nice exchange for this? You can also use craft paint. So you can buy the golden like I do because I'm a crazy person. Right?
Uh-huh.
Or you can buy craft paint just wherever you're at in your art practice. If you're a brand new student, you may not be comfortable purchasing this. And then I have the heavy bodied here. The difference being over here is the way the paint holds brush strokes.
Uh-huh.
Right? And so when you're painting with this, you definitely need a stiffer brush. When you're painting with this, you can use softer multimedia brushes.
Yeah.
So I've got one of my Simply Simmons number 4 brights here. And I'm just sort of pulling the paint out into my brush to load it up and make sure that it's at least to the halfway mark on the bristles. Because I want enough paint to start this out. And I'm going to come on the flat here. And I'm going to come up. And look, it's already starting to sort of thin out. And that's just a thing with that. And then I'm going to switch. I do this sort of twist.
Uh-huh.
This is a base move that I do. My moves. This is my ninja skills. Right here. I'll twist the brush in my hands and go to the edge. Every brush has a couple of strokes that it does.
Can you do that one more time? Hold on.
I'd do this all day. Here, we're going to do this till like at least whoever showed up today is treeing it up.
Okay, so I'm going to get in here home with Nausea Cam. I'm going to zoom in on this a little bit.
Okay.
And then I'm going to try to not...
I'm going
to
repeat that load I just did where I pull it up into the halfway mark of my bristles with the fluid.
Okay, now...
And then I'm going to show this with heavy body.
Before you move there, I can actually see the load on your bristle if you'll just turn it right there.
Okay. Can you see it to right there?
Yeah. I can zoom in a little bit.
So it's right. It's loaded to the halfway mark. I don't want it up into the ferrule.
Uh-huh.
Right? The brush doesn't explode if it gets up into the ferrule, but then you start to wear your brushes out quicker. So I'd like to try to keep them to the halfway mark on my bristles here.
Okay, cool.
So, I know there's been a lot of chatting today, but we're going to be at this a little while.
So when you go up, paint slowly because I'm going to try to track you as you go
up
there.
I'm going to try to do this slowly. So I'm coming up, and I'll try to do the same. And now it's starting to not have enough paint to really leave a firm mark, but that's okay because I don't want to come back. I twist, and my tree naturally just gets thinner. So as I twist, one thing that I can do is I can lighten my pressure. If I press hard...
Okay, you have to hold on there.
A brush stroke will be thicker, and then if I press lighter, it gets thinner. And that's just something that happens in brushes. Now I'm going to solidify this up. All trees, mostly, of course, planet Earth always likes to throw us a couple surprises. A
couple weirdo trees?
Yeah. Are thicker at the bottom and get thinner at the top.
Uh-huh.
It is very rare that they're good straight lines. They always have little wobbles in them, even the straightest trees.
Yeah.
And you want to definitely make sure your trees have wobbles and personality, or they will just feel fabricated and stiff and not fun. And I'm right now just sort of painting in this trunk space and smoothing this out because I want to taper from the bottom and have it get thinner and thinner and thinner up to the top.
Oh.
Okay, so see how I have these bases?
Yeah.
Now, one of the problems that people have, that they commonly have, and this is called the antler... is a short little branch that comes out here. And I'm calling it the antler because my good friend calls it that. And if you've ever done this, and a lot of people are like, my tree don't look right. some stuff has happened. If you've ever had that happen to you, I'm going to show you the fix right now.
I'll show you the fix for some antlers.
So what's happening is that you're creating a pattern, right? You've got a little branch come out, and then you say, hey, I want twigs. So you've got a good instinct happening, but you're not creating the fluidity that branches actually have. So like, say up here, I'm doing a little branch. What I'm going to do a little different is I'm going to go long. Go long, go long. Play football. Do, do, do. It's thicker where it's joining the trunk, thins as it tapers out, and I've got this nice long line. Now, if I were antlering, my temptation would be to come here and make two more joints off.
Okay.
But I'm going to resist it. I'm going to come down about a third of the way up from the bottom. Okay. And I'm going to go rogue.
Going to de-antler?
I'm going to come out this way.
Ooh.
Ooh. Okay. I have a lot of wonderful, chaotic, fun decisions that I can make from here. I could come about a third or halfway up this branch and bring this branch off. Or I could come over here and maybe even curve it down, because branches sometimes curve down.
Yeah.
And I could come out this way. And maybe I could add a little one here. And these guys could cross each other. Can you see how what's happened is I've created plants of really nice order, almost like a grass?
Yeah.
This is more what you'll see a grass do.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you're trying to paint grass, than what a tree will want to do. Because a tree, and if you think about the nature of what you're painting, it has to compete with other plants for sunlight and resources. And to do that, it wants to throw out branches where it's going to put leaves, like lots and lots and lots of leaves, right, to catch the sun. And it means it gets all of this resource. That's one of the things that helped me understand trees better, was look at what is the tree trying to do. It's trying to catch the sun, and it's trying to own its space. Does that make sense?
It totally does.
Now, another thing that you can do to really improve your tree experience, I'm painting this bright because I'm very comfortable with the bright. But chances are, outside of putting in the basic tree trunk, you are not comfortable with the bright. It is something that I've just become really used to, and I can make it through thick, thin lines. And, you know, you get to a place sometimes when you're painting where you practically paint with a stick and just get through. But when you're starting out, that is not the case. So, rather than fight your art materials indefinitely, I'm going to see if I can find one of my good ones. Oh, here's some. You can switch to, let me show you.
I'll zoom in on that one.
A detail.
Okay.
Ooh. See this one right here?
Yeah.
Now, this says 20 over 0. Whenever you see 5 over 0, 10 over 0, 20 over 0, any of that over 0, you are now into detail and miniature brushes, and whenever you're into those, you now have more control, a lot more control, over the thickness of your lines.
Sounds pretty reasonable.
So I'm going to come over here. I'm going to load it up. Here's the load.
I'll come in on that again. Whoop.
I don't want to take it into the ferrule, and I want most of it focused towards the tip of the brush.
Okay.
I'm going to come here so John can really follow me. And you're going to see a much more beautiful little tree line that I can create. Like, I can now really wander. And as I lighten my pressure, look how fine that line can get. I can even come right here, still on the same load, and get this fine line. Boy, I'm just barely kissing the canvas. Look at that little twig I can get. I can get as fiddly as I like. Now, I'm always, always going to make sure that my branches are thinner than what they're attached to. Another thing I'm going to do is I'm going to come here, roll off my brush to kind of get rid of the excess paint. I might even rinse out.
Now, is that a short liner brush or just a round?
This is, they don't have it, and it's a liner brush. It's one of the liners. Okay. This is Royal and Langnickel. Any miniature set will work. The Royal Langnickel packs will work. You don't have to have firm filaments for these, because chances are you're going to be moving to a soft-bodied paint, Or you're going to be doing what I'm about to show you, which is to thin your paint enough to make it soft-bodied.
Now,
because you need to thin, you need to make your paint more fluid to succeed at branches.
How many branches is too many branches?
Ooh. So what I suggest, my mission that I give you is Google trees. Google oak tree.
Uh-huh.
You're going to see so many branches, you're going to think, I'd never get all those painted. Most trees are very busy, busy little bodies. They have a lot of work going on. They're
twiggy.
Really trying to get sunlight. They're really, they're really trying to get their resources.
Now,
so I'm coming here, I'm loading. Can you see that load? I'm just dipping it in this paint, pulling it out.
Before you jump over there, can I say thank you guys to everybody who's come here today? We have a full room. There's over 275 people here. It's really, like all of our moderators are doing such a great job. Thank you guys. Yeah. And there's been lots of love given in the room. Thanks for all the
light
keepers.
We want to make sure we get to every single question. My goal today, I don't care. I just want everyone to walk away going, I feel better about trees today than I did yesterday. That's my goal. So you ask as many questions as you need to till we all feel better about trees today than we did yesterday. Okay, I'm going to reload this. I'm going to reload. I'm going to come over and show John again.
See the
load here?
I'm pulling in on that just real quick. Yeah. Now, there's a question here. There you go. Should the branches be longer than the trunk for scale?
Oh, that's a very interesting question, right? No, not in general. Though on occasion, if you think about it, if you look at oaks, you will see an oak that might have a branch that feels longer than the top of the tree.
Okay.
Right? And if you look up, if you read some arborist blogs, which I have, and they will tell you for the type of tree that you're trying to paint, that there is actually some math on how the tree grows itself out, for how long the tap roots have to be, for how long the branches can be. And that actually changes from tree to tree.
Oh, yeah.
I'm gonna come here and make another little branch.
Okay, where are you at?
I'm gonna come just right here. Maybe I'll come off here.
Okay.
This branch is gonna have to be the same thickness or thinner than the one it attaches to. I'm going to wander up and around. I'm getting very fiddly with my tree here. And the more fiddly I can be, the more interesting it'll be. This is still a decorative tree, though. This is not like I took a picture of a tree and I'm painting that actual tree. I'm painting an emotional tree here. Right? But you can see how this branch feels more branchy than this branch.
Yeah.
And this is about going long. Say that to yourself even sometimes. Go long. You know, remind yourself that, hey, branches, sometimes they bend down.
Yeah.
Right? Sometimes branches bend down. Sometimes they, go different directions. One thing that you might do, now, if you were to try to do this with just heavy-bodied paint and not to thin it, I'm going to give you some ideas of what that might look like. So I'm going to come here. I've got the heavy body loaded up on the tip, like we always do.
I'm coming in on there.
The brush is not particularly wet.
And there were some girls that were just wanting to say, hello.
Hello. I don't have any. I kind of have hollow on my nails, but I need to redo my nails.
They were asking about that. That's why.
Yeah, I have a little hollow on my nails, but I gotta re-hollow. I got some new stuff.
Okay.
Based on her new videos. Isn't that sad? But I did. All right, so you can kind of see that. We're going to come right here. I'm going to come up. And you can kind of see how that goes.
Oh, you're too fast for me. Oh, man.
Sorry.
That's right.
I actually tried to go slow, too.
I know. my camera's just a little too slow. Oh, God, I'm going to come down.
So I'm going to come back with that second coat. And it's going to probably take it because this is going to not be flowy off my brush. So I'm going to have to definitely, and I'd have to have a stiff brush. If I used a soft brush, do I have a soft brush over here? I do. Let me show you what goes wrong with a soft brush. I have a soft brush right here. I'm going to get it just damp, and I'm going to load it up on the tip. This is a wonderful multimedia brush, Simply Simmons. It's a wash, right? And you can see it loses its ability to push the paint into the canvas much sooner. However, if I come next to it, I'm going to get my soft bodied and I load it. Look at that. How much different is that soft bodied paint than the heavy bodied paint with the soft brush? Can you guys see that difference? and coming here, how like much more it just flows right off the brush. And I want to talk to y'all about this because you have different decisions to make as an artist, right? I talk a lot about buy the best materials that your budget will allow. And how that kind of works is like, well, maybe you're not going to get ruby satin brushes this month because they're like some good money, right? They're great brushes, but they're some good money.
Must save your art pennies for those.
Right? Maybe you're going to get Royal and Lang nickel like I have here, or you're going to grab the Simply Simmons, multimedia brushes that have the lighter filaments, right? The firm filaments are this sort of dark, but the multimedia ones that you can find almost anywhere have a softer bristle. If your brush choices mean you only get a softer bristle, you must switch to soft body paint or increase the flow of your heavy body. And honestly, if you're on a budget, I would say switch to the soft body paint or an economy pro paint like gallery acrylic or student paint, because the body won't have so much intensity to it. It's not designed to hold brush strokes. It's not designed to do any of those stiff peaks. It's going to be more fluid. So those are things that you can do in your own art practice to be like, okay, I really got to save some money so I can get this pack of Royal and Lang nickel brushes, and I get this pack of gallery acrylic, and all I got to do is add phthalo blue and dioxazine purple to that, and I am really under budget. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense? Then you add like acrylic paper to it. You can get that daily cost of painting down and down and down and down and down.
Yeah. Now, real quick question on your brush there.
Anything.
Natural bristle brushes. Will acrylic ruin those?
No.
No.
Other than it ruins all brushes. This one. It's going to stain it.
Yeah.
Here, I'll hold it here. It's going to stain it. And you can see that stain. You can really work and work and work to clean it, but you're going to find that your natural bristles are going to get some stain. This isn't going to come off on the canvas.
Yeah.
You know, your big thing with acrylic is keeping it out of here by drawing and washing correctly and by taking care of the brushes. We'll extend the life of them. So your choices are to not spend very much money on them. That's why I like Simply Simmons, $3.
Yeah.
But there's other $3 brushes, or to take care of the good ones that you have so they last a reasonable amount of time and your investment isn't wasted. But that's what you can expect from your bristles there. So just sort of that little light staining. That can be really upsetting for some people, but it actually doesn't harm the brush. As an interesting side effect. And I think this is on the... Okay, good. I was like, is this there? You know... you can see these soft bristles here. These don't stain as badly, but they have stained a little bit, you know, and it's about how, you know, you clean them and you hold them up and that's what's going on. So those are things that you can do to improve your branch experience. You might be thinking, I'm really terrible at trees. And it's not that you're, you know, not lengthening your branches enough or anything. It's that you've got soft, bristled brushes on that crazy canvas that doesn't take paint. You know, and the brush doesn't have enough detail and the paint isn't fluid enough. And it's a whole bunch of functional problems, but it's not you. Mm-hmm. If that makes total sense to everybody.
So while there's a question about will you teach some willow branches?
Mm-hmm.
But I'd also like to say, because we're at 280 people. And thank you all for coming. If you guys end up painting any trees, please post them up there so we can see all your pretty trees. We like to see those. Don't forget to like, comment, subscribe. And if you have some friends that you'd like to join us.
Looking at a brush, that's why I'm looking down.
Please invite them over. But also, don't forget to hit the like button, because if we get to 300, yeah, we try to do the Sherpa dance. And today we've been kind of drilled down, but we do like to dance and get down and have some fun here. But today's been all about the facts.
I know it's been a little bit about the facts. I'm going to load up this round. So this is a multimedia round, but I put it in my soft body paint.
Okay.
It's not that different from what I did on these little branches.
Okay, well, I'm going to get over there.
So I can sit there and use this round, lightening my pressure, to create a nice little branch that has wonderful line to it. See how beautifully the paint flows off my brush?
Yeah.
That is the combo of the soft-bodied, right, and the wonderful canvas, which is this canvas paper, which is just Strathmore canvas paper, in a light pressure. So if I press hard, it's like this.
Hold on.
Pressure, pressure, pressure. I'm pushing in, pushing in, pushing in.
Okay. Now.
Pushing in, pushing in, pushing in, pushing in. See how thick that is?
Yeah.
So that's another thing that I see happening to people. I'm going to load back up again to halfway up. They'll be like, I'm gonna do a tree, and they'll start light here, and then they'll press in maybe, and then they'll get lighter, and it gets crazy like that. And they're like, what happened? Pressure. You know?
You had light tree pressure?
You didn't have the right pressure at the beginning. You can press the hardest at the beginning of your stroke, right? That should be your hardest pressure, and then as your stroke goes up, you should lighten that pressure to the tip of the brush.
Mm.
See? But even so, like, this isn't a very tree-looking tree. This is more bush size in relationship to everything on the canvas. I still need to take this up, you know. Still need to take these, like, bits up. Oh, there's something cool I want to show everybody.
Okay.
Sorry, I'm excited. I know this is a long quest, guys, but, I mean, if you guys can get through these tree things, all of it, because then we can get into realistic trees and we can get into bark and knots and
mm-hmm.
really painting trees like some of those paintings y'all send me. You know, so I'm going to load this up. I was rinsing that brush off. I've got my detail I showed you earlier.
Mm-hmm.
All right, this one is the 10-0. I'm going to load it up. Okay, where was I? Oh, maybe some willowing down.
Willow trees, yeah. They definitely want
to
be.
So if this was
trees.
To suddenly become very willow-like, what I do is I curve it up, and then I allow gravity to pull it down. I'm going to make just this little cluster of branch look like willow. And then it's going to have one little friend that thinks it's going to escape, but he's not going to escape. He's going to get pulled down.
Gravity got the best of him.
Gravity got the best of him. Really taper these at the end. Taper, taper, taper them at the end. His little friend, but no, he did not get away. And he has a little friend here that comes out, but he doesn't get it. How willowy does that look?
Wow, that's really cool.
Right? Just imagine that gravity has pulled your tree friend down. And sometimes trees will grow down. Oaks have a lot of branches that go down.
Yeah.
They just do. If you've climbed a tree and you really think about it for a minute, how'd you get up? Think about those things on your tree. How did you get up? Well, maybe your tree had a little knot here, right? And then a little branch that was more down like this. And that gave you that foothold up. You just got to be thinking about, what does this tree want to do? And who does this tree want to be? And that can really help you understand what's going on. And this is all if we're just doing trees without any branches, leaves.
Uh-huh.
Right. We're just right now getting into trees, just their structure. Right? I'm going to give myself another
trees.
Sheet. I'm going to have to get some new pad paper soon.
Mm-hmm.
And that's okay. I don't mind.
I'm watching you tear
and
it
you
off.
Can kind of just see how this is. It's just paper with this coating. All right, so we're going to go like that. Now, another thing I'm going to show you, this is sort of interesting, is bamboo, if you guys don't mind.
Oh, sure. If we can go learn how to bamboo, I'd like to learn bamboo.
You would like to know some bamboo?
I don't know how to bamboo.
You don't know how to bamboo? So now this here is a double load flat wave brush. Let me show it to you on the close up.
Okay.
Double load flat wave brush. This is a wave.
Uh-huh.
Flat. Pretty literal here because you can see a wave.
He's
and
wavy.
It's flat. This is an angle, which you probably already have.
Flip it over. Just flip it. No, the other way. Yeah.
These are called the duets, and they're by Foxtrot. There's companies that do this. They can just make your life seem super easy. If you don't have, yes, you could probably with scissors trim a flat and get something similar. Because it's just about this having this sort of like nice little, if you're a hairdresser, you're probably all good.
Yeah.
These are softer makeup applying filaments.
Hmm.
And the reason is because we're going to use a softer paint. All one stroke, all technique, double load, all that crazy that you see, 15 minute roses, that is all about the softness of the paint. You don't do that with hard body paints.
Interesting.
So I'm going to show you just a basic double load bamboo. So I'm going to come over and I've got some light green and dark green.
All right. I'm seeing it.
You know, this is sort of pro economy paint. This is System 3 Dollar and Rally paint.
Okay.
Pro economy paint. So it's actually pretty soft bodied. And I'm going to double load it. See how I came over here and I got a little bit and then I came over in half and half. I'm going to show you the brush over here.
All right. Help me get over there and I'm going to come down on that. Oops. Wrong way. Oh, yeah. You literally have it on. Okay, cool.
Right.
Now, where are you going to put that?
I'm going to come over here. I'm going to flatly plant this on my canvas and come up and then stop. And then I'm going to load again.
That's it?
This is all you have to do. I'm going to load again.
Okay.
And then I'm going to come next to this where the joint is. I'm going to wiggle a little bit, and then I'm going to load again.
Okay. What?
And then I'm going to come over here and load it. You guys are probably like, wait, what? I'm going to wiggle a little bit, and I'm going to load again.
Okay.
All right, so I've got this going on. And I'm going to kind of redo this because this didn't have a nice thing. If you've got any area in your double load, right? Then I'm going to do what's called a little S-stroke. It's very literal. I'm loading on the green. And you can do this more often than you think. And I'm going to plant down and I'm going to go S.
Okay.
I do not have the best S-stroke on the planet, but I got the basic gist of it. And S. What does that look like?
It's looking like some little bamboo things.
Isn't it? Yeah, we're going to do a whole thing kind of based on this idea. Well, I see I got too flat, and I didn't twist it out, but then I did, so I fixed it. Yeah. Sometimes that'll happen to you. These are practice-based techniques, and...
Didn't you teach some flower techniques using heavy body? Some ones like some thick impasto flowers and stuff?
Yeah, I took the decorative rose.
Yeah.
Okay, so there's a rose that all decorative painters, the history of all decorative painting time does, have done, which is, and I think Angela Anderson actually explained the rose the best, which is why her lesson is I carded in there where it's like a brick.
Yeah.
Where it goes stroke, brick, stroke, brick, stroke, brick. And yeah, we did that with heavy body paint.
Ah.
And so we got to take it in sort of a new, fresh direction. But it was based on a really tried and true concept of decorative painting.
Gotcha.
Don't allow anyone to ever treat you bad and go, oh, you're a decorative painter. I'm not encouraging violence, but definitely, definitely walk away from them. I find that to be the rudest, one of the rudest things fine artists could do to other artists.
There was a rumble at Hoot this year.
Right, because it's not like you don't have, I'm sorry, I'm going to get a soapbox. Go ahead, thumb me down, whatever you got to do about it. But this is my soapbox. If somebody is a very skilled decorative painter and they've spent their life, 20 years or whatever, learning this set of skills, and they're designing, they're still designing, they're still being creative, they're still being imaginative, they're just using a particular set of skills, media, and tools. Mm-hmm. So everybody can just back off of them.
And
as far as I'm concerned.
And as far as craftsmanship and master techniques, yeah. I think that they have it in their own right. So
yeah, it's just, it's like when people are like, oh, they're just an illustrationist. Well,
tell you what, one of the most, you know, prolific...
More S-strokes right here at the joint.
Chuck Carson, one of the most prolific and awesome illustration artists.
I'm going to keep painting because I'm going to keep going while my paint's wet, but yep. John's going to explain about Chuck.
He's awesome. Everybody loves Chuck. You guys know who Chuck is. He does all the awesome artwork that we have up in our lower thirds and things like that. He's the animated pencil. We'll leave an iCard in the description so you can go over and like, comment, subscribe, and share on his stuff because he's awesome, which you should do here while you're here.
Aren't those fun little bamboo leaves?
Those are.
Most fun little bamboo leaves. Another common, and I think I sent it to you, the cherry branch reference. Okay. Cherry branches.
Oh, cherry branches. Let me see if I can find those. You talk to them. I'll find cherry.
My guys are, while you're looking, I'm gonna come over on my... I'm going to say like this. So there's this whimsical tree. There's kind of a spooky tree. There's, there's cherry branches. There's some basic trees that we want to do. We want to do willows. We want to do, no items. Like, there it is. We want to do cherry trees. So right now, our current branch that we're most commonly doing, I'm going to kind of put in here so we can have a comparison.
Okay.
Right. So our most common branch is like the one we did with the girl on the swing. I come off the canvas, my fluid paint is loaded on my bright, I come out here and I'm painting a nice little branch, maybe it wanders down. You guys have done this with me, two birds might sit on it, right?
Yeah.
And then One of the other things, and I talk about this, if you do any gardening, think about those little nodules that plants grow where they can have new branches or offshoots.
Mm-hmm.
You will see in your own stroke, as long as you don't stay very rigid, if you kind of allow it to wander around, that there's almost an implied nodule along the way. And you can use those to help you decoratively plan where to put your branches.
Mm-hmm.
Something I like to do. So this is sort of that traditional branch. Maybe I'm going to come up here and create an offshoot. So say I'm picking distances. I'm trying to vary my distances between things. Right? I'm varying my distances. And then I'm coming along on the edge here. And then look, there's a bend there, isn't there?
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's a tree opportunity if I ever saw one. And then there's a little implied bend there for a little upward branch. Oh, my goodness. See, there's always these little opportunities in your painting
mm-hmm.
to tell you where you can imaginatively enjoy yourself.
Yeah.
These kinds of trees are a good cousin to Zen doodling. Truly, they are. And then you can get your detail branch. This is, you know, this nice liner. Number 20.
Yep.
Loaded up on the tip. Didn't even have to get it wet. And you can work out the edges of these branches. Right? Look at that.
Oh-ho.
And take this into a much more tree place. What am I doing? I found a bend. I'm going to come here and grab it. Oh, I found another little bend. Let's go get that. But what am I? Okay, so there's something gone wrong on my brush that I'm adjusting. I don't know if you can zoom on this to see this.
Find where you're at. There you are. Okay, hold on.
Okay, can you see it?
I can. I'm zooming in.
Almost. Really zoom in.
All right, I'm in there.
Okay. Do I need to hold against the white or against my hand?
Yeah, you're okay. I can see it either way.
Do you see how the tip of the bristles are sticking out from the bead?
Yeah.
At that moment, you must clean the brush and reload.
Okay.
You need to start looking for that happening on your brush. If the bead or the load of your paint has moved up the bristles, and the deploying end, this tip, is bare, it's time to wipe or rinse, right? If you rinse, you have to wipe off and reload back onto the tip again.
Gotcha.
Like this.
All right, I want to get back up there. Where you're at?
And then I'm right here, and I found a little bend in the halfway mark of my branch. And I'm coming up. And I'm lightening my pressure. Oh, it's so light, it's so light, it's so light. And I know my brush is okay because it's dispensing paint easily. And I'm going, I might wander down. It's okay if I wander up and down.
You can wander around?
Mm-hmm. Another thing I want to show you is that on a branch, when I'm trying to say it's very fine, it is okay if the line breaks a little bit. Your eye will finish it.
Yeah?
On a painting, it really will. Right? So you've got that happening. The broken line is a good way to create a fine, fine, fine branch. I get so light on my pressure that maybe some of the line breaks. That's all right. It's okay. What happens when you let this happen is that it seems like the twig is maybe distant or fine. And so that's another little thing that you can allow to have happen in your branch. Mm-hmm. Cherry blossoms, however, they do their own thing. Seriously, they do. And I'm going to try to explain that. Though to explain the mind of a cherry blossom tree is a journey I think that a million brilliant ink artists in Japan have really explored. And you should definitely read everything they have to say about it. I consider myself a cherry novice because I certainly haven't dedicated 10,000 hours to just the cherry blossom branch. And always take advantage of somebody else's passion and read up what they have to say because you never know what's going to click for you. You know, like I might explain 9/10 of what you need to know about a tree, but that other pivotal 1/10 might be from somewhere else. You as a student, you've got to be like hungry.
Yeah.
Right? It's not, remember we talked about that? Do I read the menu? That's like taking tutorials, reading art books, and do I digest the meal?
Now, While we're on trees, I have so.
I'm gonna load my bright. Okay. Who's here?
Everybody is here.
Hi, everybody.
So hi, everybody. I know we're like Sherpa's on.
Okay, I will stop, we'll do that, and then we'll do tree.
I was gonna say that they would like to know about more tree. We're gonna stay on tree questions.
You can. I don't care. You can ask anything. How many monkeys fit in a barrel? I don't know. Some monkeys.
Actually, there was a question earlier of how many Ewoks fit in a barrel. I'm not even kidding.
Too many scary Ewoks.
Just don't touch as many.
I actually bet that somewhere on a blog somewhere, some Star Wars aficionado has actually calculated the amount of Ewoks. Because they're like chinchillas, I feel like Ewoks probably have an inverse chinchilla principle.
They will. I mean, like, just
you
don't
can fit a lot of chinchilla in one. All the chinchilla owners just exploded right now, all two of them. But you can fit a lot of chinchilla in one fishbowl, can't you? With their little eyeballs and like against the glass and their little paws, and they're like, chinchilla. Sorry. Or we can answer our questions. Okay.
With a whimsical tree with a door in the trunk, how do you make the above ground roots look real?
Above ground roots. That's a fantastic question. Let's do above ground roots. And then we'll do the cherry tree.
And then you'll do the door in the tree?
I said the cherry tree, but I can do a door too. What are we doing? Roots or door in a tree?
Start with roots.
Okay,
roots.
So we're going to start with roots. So we got to begin our tree. So I'm going to load up my bright because that's a brush I'm comfortable with, right? And now I'm going to come, I'm actually going to, because I want this tree to be a little thicker. Because when you see roots is when a tree is more established, because the tree has to send out roots to hold its weight.
Right.
Right? That's what's actually happening is the tree is holding on to the ground. And there is often more happening under the earth than you ever see above. So I'm going to take this nice little tree. And I made this kind of crazy little line here. Okay. And I want to say I have a thicker tree. So I'm going to come over maybe an inch and a half. I'm going to reload my brush so I'm not like hungry for paint. And the trick is I'm going to have parallel lines that sort of follow the weirdness that I've already laid in. Right? So see, but they don't need to be straight. You don't want them to be smooth. And not messy. You really, really want them to be messy. And maybe it goes off here, right? So we're going to paint this in solid. Because we're just doing a silhouette tree here.
Yeah.
And even if we were doing a tree with bark and stuff, and maybe we'll add some bark to this tree in a second, I've got the colors to do it from even here with the black paint. Though I'd probably do like a Payne's gray or any color besides just pure black.
Now, can you also talk about depth and how you put that into the tree a little later?
Yeah.
Because that was something that was interesting.
We'll just tree up here. Someday I got to make a short tree clinic, but this one is for our community, so you guys have tree success everywhere you go.
Yeah.
That's what I'm here for. So I've got this sort of base, like, tree in, and all right, I'm going to sit there and say, hey, my tree friend, I see kind of a bend here where you could have had a little nodule way back in the day. And I'm going to give you the branch that goes off that direction.
Ooh.
Because I like you. Talk to your tree. It actually helps. You know, we're following it up parallel. And we're wandering on out. Right? Well, now we've got a pretty good bend happening here, don't we?
Yeah.
That must be answered with a branch.
Oh.
Maybe that branch just goes down a little bit.
I think you got distracted by branches.
No, I have to put them in to put the roots in.
Oh, do you?
Yeah.
Oh,
that
wow.
helps me understand where my roots are going to be.
Oh, why?
Because mentally, I need to get a sense of the scale of my tree.
For me personally,
I like a sense of the scale of my tree. It helps me get a sense of the scale of my roots and find balance between the two. So I'm just sort of sketching in some branch relationships so I know, this tree is like this. Because then I'll be like, what kind of roots hold this bad boy up?
That makes sense.
Right.
All right. Hadn't thought about it like that.
I'm not saying this is the right way to think about it. I'm just saying it's what I've been doing up till now. There could be an even better, more clever way, and that is what Pinterest is for. And never feel afraid to look there because there's some good information. So this tree is sort of in front of his little tree friend. While I'm here, I can sit there and say, like, if I was to say, like, there's some like little branching going off that way and then this one. And so it is the winding of the branches that create depth and the way that they taper off into the distance that might imply something is happening. Like Bean Man. Like when we did Bean Man.
Oh yeah.
All right, so I kind of have a sense a little bit of the size of my tree here now.
You got some big branches up there.
And this line has already kind of indicated where I might possibly put... Now, he's got a big, giant taproot that goes down, which is the root that goes straight down deep into the earth. May go far... What is it, the roots? If you are an arborist, please share this, but I believe the roots are twice as long down into the earth as the tree is tall.
Some trees.
Yeah. I think a lot of the oaks and stuff like that. Not as much the eucalyptus. Arborists weigh in.
Tree people.
So I'm going to imagine my earth is here. And I'm going to bring this wonderful root out. See how it's kind of an interesting reflection of this branch up here? And it will also taper. There's the taper. So these can be thicker than you might do branches up here, because you have to imagine this tree is attempting to hold on to the earth. And you can even say, all right, you've got some little friends here that are trying to hold on to the earth that maybe I'm seeing above the ground. Right? And then maybe this has got like a little wandering down friend that's gripping hard, sticking to the ground. It's coming together. It's parallel. You see how it goes together?
Yeah.
So what I'm always doing, and I'll try to even get more explainy, and if I'm not being explainy enough, man, people hold me to task. Hold me to task. I'm going to come off this side, and I'm going to give him another grippy root. All right, so here it is. Maybe it's got a knot on it. Roots can do some things that the branches won't do because they're fighting against the earth. We don't know that there's not a rock. We don't know what's happening there. But we're implying that something is happening there. Once I've made these lines, my parallel, I don't want it to be smooth, but I do want it to sort of follow the previous path and taper to a point.
Can you put some shaded depth on that for us to show us how you would do that?
Yes.
Cool.
Yes, yes, yes. I'm going to come here. I can do it all in black and white. We can do all the bark in black and white.
Okay.
Or in colors. It doesn't really matter. So I'm just kind of breaking off some brand. Like, this is some story here, right? We're putting in these roots because it has to be believable that this big boy is attached to the ground. I might even switch to a round. I had a round earlier. Where did I put it down? Here it is. I'm going to rinse it off. Now, maybe I'll use this round to continue fleshing out these roots, because we're still talking roots here. I'm going to break off a little bit out this way. And I'm going to break off a little bit out this way. Here I come. Oh, that's wonderful. Oh... See how it's starting to feel more like there are roots in the ground?
Yeah.
I haven't even had grass or anything that creates depth. Well, I might come over here and say, oh, you've got a little friend there. Maybe this little guy grips down. You're looking to create... Now, again, we're painting decoratively at this stage, because we're not looking at an actual tree. No. So there's design happening here. Balance. Am I... representing what I know about trees accurately. If you want to continue to paint better and better, more realistic trees, it's very important to use reference photos. Very important. And put out some white.
While you're doing that, can I ask a question about technique-based stuff?
Okay, yeah, we just gotta, yes, let's remember what we said we were gonna cover so we don't forget to cover it. Okay. So far we still have cherry blossom to cover and texture on this tree.
Yeah. So what I was going to ask, why you're doing that, you don't use the fan brush very often here, though.
No.
Why is that?
You know, that is definitely a technique brush like the Wave.
Uh-huh.
And it does a nice tree. And I'll demo that today. And okay, I may even demo that in future lessons. You know, I think it can be kind of nice in combination with a palette knife in natural landscapes. And it has a place. My issue with fan brushes at the moment are most of the fan brushes are created for oil paint or softer body paint. I paint heavy body. It's really hard to find a fan brush that has stiff enough bristles to really work a heavy body paint.
Oh.
It's really challenging. Sort of like it's kind of hard to find a deerfoot stippler sometimes.
Deerfoot stippler.
But it's okay. We have a hack for that.
We do.
Yeah, for clouds and that kind of thing.
And deerfoot stipplers.
Yes, and deerfoot stipplers. We have it. So I'm going to get another bright. I like brights because they give me, especially these firm filaments. You can just see I'm killing my brushes here. It's the number six. Here goes the number six. You can see how the bright is square. It has a nice edge. And I'm going to load up my next kind of color of paint. And John, for giggles and stuff, tell me which direction the light is coming from.
Left.
From the left.
I guess.
So now I'm going to...
Can it be underlit, like from a fire?
It could, but I'm going to go left.
Start simple.
So I'm going to just kind of pull in this brush. So everything is loaded here. If you look,
it is a
mixture of black and white.
Yeah, I see.
Kind of half and half. It's mostly concentrated here at the tip. That way, when I come here and I'm very lightly touching the canvas, see how it just catches the texture of the canvas?
Yeah, let me slow that.
And it's very rough. That's going to help me have a kind of barky story. And I'm focusing this highlight. If the light's coming from here, then it's the left side of the branch that's going to have some highlight to it.
Huh.
I would want to leave this dark, but then I could start picking it up here on the left side of this branch. Right? And come down my trunk even and say, oh, hey, let's bring this around here. And I'm being very dashy, if you notice, with my brush strokes. And rough, because I'm trying to say this is bark.
Bark.
Bark is rough and intense. And I can highlight the top of my root. Highlight the top. Highlighting the top. And I know this is like, man, this is like mind-numbing. But for those of you guys hanging in, it will help.
And we just want to get confirmation that you'll also help teach evergreens.
Yes.
Okay.
I will also help teach evergreens because I know how y'all feel about that.
Okay.
So there we go. I'll show a couple things. So I am, then right here, say this is a very round root. I could leave a shadow right here and here and come here up the center, leaving two dark areas, implying the roundness. Do the same here. And then maybe just a little bit on the inside, but this would be much more in shadow. I can come up my trunk here with this highlight. And then on the inside of that branch and a little bit on the inside of this one. See how the tree's starting to take shape?
Yeah.
If I get at least one more value, and this doesn't matter whether it's brown or what colors that you're using, of gray up, I can really, really start to... Oh, so what I did... is I didn't rinse my brush and I just came and got white. See, I'm just pulling the white into my brush.
Yeah.
And I flip and pull the white in, and I flip and I pull the white in. This is allowing me to get a nice load into my brush. Load looks like this. It's from the halfway point to the tip. It's a nice soft dove gray. It's not wet because I didn't add water to it. And now when I come here and I'm just very light and relaxed, I use the texture of the paint. This is where heavy body is fantastic. Because this is heavy body, it did a mild texture. Because the canvas is textured, it has a mild texture. And that allows me as a painter to lightly brush over the top of that. It catches these highlights, these like different little bumps, and look what it does. Isn't that feeling very bark light?
Yeah.
And I'm just, the brush being stiff is helping me here. Everything about my setup is helping me tell a story of a rough surface. The way I'm changing up the direction of my brushes is helping me tell the story of a rough surface. This is all flat. I'm a complete liar here. There's no tree. And I'm trying to lie really, really well. Art is one of these things where you're lying to tell the truth. Isn't it so funny?
You're an illusionist.
Huh?
You're an illusionist.
I'm an illusionist. But I'm telling you true things about the world, true things that we feel. I'm just using these techniques to do it. And you can just see how directionality kind of can imply that this is round. Every highlight that I continue to put on here will enforce the idea that this tree has texture, is rough, has a light source. We're talking about its light source. That's what they'll tell you in school. Where's your light? You got to find your light. Not just models have to find their light. Artists need to know their light.
Right.
And honestly, since I can't take a picture or selfie to save my life, I'm really glad I decided to be an artist. Because I can't smize. I try. I can't do it. But I can find my light source for my tree.
I would have never thought that I was going to end up being a camera person.
It's crazy, right? Yeah. I'm going to pull even maybe a little more highlight. I haven't rinsed my brush, right? So now it's not white.
Hold on.
But it's lighter. The previous paint is still there. I didn't rinse my brush. So since I've got Mars black with my titanium white, there's going to be a tint even as I paint. It won't come across as pure bright white. And I can just add another layer of texture. If I were doing this in colors that reminded us of trees, right? And I could get into dappled light. It's incredible once you can just relax into the space, what you can do. See how that's just not even a... It's just really... I'm sorry, I'm moving around. This is something artists do, and it makes it hard on John, and I apologize.
It's Chase the Sherpa time.
It is Chase the Sherpa. We need a faster robot cam.
Well, what it is, I'm just really zoomed in. So I think if I zoomed out a little bit during
I think, but I know they love to see it. So I'm going to come right up here in this middle trunk, and I'm just going to put some highlight right here. Now, if we add color theory to this, boy, we are on to something now. Scrambling around, being rough, changing up the direction of my brush. I also roll my brush in my fingers a lot. I got to talk about that more, the roll. Because it's a subconscious thing that you'll start to do as an artist where you're looking for fresh spots of paint on your brush or palette knife. And there you go. And I'm going to keep this story in black and white. And the reason I'm going to keep this story in black and white for you guys is that I want you to see the tones and the structure.
Okay.
Before we worry about other things. Next one, we're going to use the palette knife and the fan brush.
Oh.
And we still have to do cherry blossoms.
Okay.
Because we mentioned that, and we should definitely do whatever we mention. This is my favorite palette knife.
Okay.
This is like the Bob. I like to call this the Bob. I don't know. This particular brand is a creative mark, and I can get them easily. All right. So we talked about when you're loading up a palette knife, you load it the direction of your stroke. Right, so if I'm stroking right, I've got to load it to the right side. If I'm going to stroke left with it, I've got to load it to the left side. So, but I'm going to do the traditional bead. And I'm going to do it with just a little kind of black and white here. And I might need to really pull this out. Because what I want is, and I'll show this to you when you see, I'm just going to grab everything. I want this bead, and I may need to pull this off and reload because there it is.
Okay.
So there's a bead here. I'm going to show it to you on the up close cam. See the bead?
All right. Let me get in there on
my
that.
My mom talks about this all the time. My mom and the bead. There's a little white pigment in there. There's a little black pigment in there. It's really close on the edge.
Yep. We see that. Okay.
So that I can tap.
Where are you going to go at?
Right? I'm going to go in the center here. Tap the brush to create. This is not dissimilar to what Angela does with her little credit cards.
Which is really cool.
Yeah.
If you have not seen it, you should jump over to Angela.
I'm just tapping this straight up to create my tree line. Tapping, tapping, tapping. Right? Tap, tap, tap. Just tapping. Oh, there's a trunk here. Isn't that fun? Tapping. The fact that the paint is loaded the way that it is, I still remember everything I know about trees, which means this trunk has got to be... I might need to reload a little bit. Which is wipe off and then scrape back on the brush. Always super fun. Come to bottom. Make sure that my trunk is a little thicker at the bottom than as it goes up, right?
Yep.
Now I can do the bob here. If we remember the bob, we go, hey, there's a little branch here. Maybe a branch here. And maybe a branch there. Maybe a branch here. Just tap it. I need to put out some more paint. I don't know why I'm being cheap with paint today. There's no reason. What is going on with me? I don't know.
I don't know.
Put out a little bit. Doesn't take actually a lot. Sometimes we feel like palette knife painting takes a lot of paint, but it's efficient with it, so it's an interesting sort of thing. So I'm going to pull it out. I'm going to do the butter thing. You pull it out, see, I press flat, and you get that little smear. And then you scrape, and that's how you get the bead.
A little smear.
And then I smear. Yes, if you're good at bagels, you're going to be good at the palette knife. So I'm going to come down here and give a little branch, maybe, and this will go a little further, and I can be like, you can even kind of do a drag, too. My mom's very fond of the drag. You know, where you've got this sort of, do we all feel like there's a tree happening here now?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It kind of reminds me, it's I like the very loose, impressionistic kind of feeling that you get from these.
Now, here's what's fun. I'm going to load up some white and do my little scrapey things. It's not perfect. If I come along, and I've kept everything loaded to the right, and I scrape across, look what it is. Oh, yeah. No, it's a birch tree.
I love how that, you know.
It's birch. Yeah, drop the knife. It's a little palette knife birch tree. It just could not be more fun and easy.
Yeah.
Let's say I was doing the Bob Ross pine.
Okay.
I'm going to reload up. I've got my white and my black pigment. His little friend is maybe a pine. I'm going to come up here and say pine, 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 pine. It also helps to say the word pine, pine. I have a little pine tree.
Is that the pine tree?
Maybe his little friend is going to be a little bit leany. I got to get some more paint. My friend is leany. He leaned over. He wasn't paying attention when he grew. He's doing his own thing. Pine, 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 pine. He's a shorter pine. And you could be a nice, kind of nice, more straight. You're like more straight and narrow. If it gets away from you, just reload, which is just a scrape. And can you guys see it? Just, this is the bead.
I could see it till you moved.
This is the whole thing on palette knives is about that bead. Everything on the palette knife is about that bead.
Tilt it. Oh, go back where you had it. So tilt it because there's the black paint behind. Oh, see, the black paint makes it look a little different. So,
all right. Can you just see that little bead?
Yeah.
Let me go here. This is a bigger tree because I made the thunk. If you get a thick tree, you got to take it up higher. That's how you fix that. You're like, no, that tree just got tall. This is how it is. I'm just kind of like. Hey, my tree has leaves. I'm sorry. I can't help it.
Windy leaves.
Huh?
Windy leaves.
Look, it's going to be like, I just grabbed some white. I'm not working hard here. Tree, 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 tree.
You're just going to make some tree.
I'm just going to make some tree, man. I'm not going to be stressed. This is tree, 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 tree. Anybody feel the tree yet?
Oh, yeah.
Are we feeling it? We know we have an inner tree. My inner tree. Loves me. And I'm just loading to the right and stroking to the right. Tree. Maybe we'll do a painting based on that. I don't know. So I'm going to wipe off my knife. I'm going to get my brush out. Now, this is the Princeton Art and Brush Company 54FN fan. Why am I telling you? Because it's too stiff for makeup. Went through all of Texas Art Supply. If you saw the Facebook Live, found two fans I didn't hate.
Yeah.
It's hard. Not that the other fans aren't good, for what they are.
It's the fan you're a fan of.
It's the fan I'm a fan of. It's wrong, John.
It's wrong.
It's wrong. So we gotta put a little green out just so there's some green feeling to my tree. And that's okay that it's heavy bodied. I'm only going to get this wet enough to warm it up so the bristles aren't, completely dry.
Uh-huh.
But I don't want it sopping, and these have the tendency to want to get sopping. And I'm going to pull a little black into my green here so I have a nice, really kind of deepy, obnoxious-y green color. And you can see how I'm pulling it out. I'm loading the brush. This is the load on the fan.
Hold on a second. Now, while I'm moving that down here, I'm collecting up a bunch of questions for you for after we're done with some of these brush techniques.
So, okay, I'm just here to, literally, this is me just being here with you guys until we're all good.
Yeah, so just so the community knows, I'm saving up some of the questions. Okay. I'm trying to keep them on topic here, so as we go through, but I'm going to be getting to them.
And we're going to keep talking about trees. My goal is everybody's good on trees. So I've got my fan loaded. You can see that load. I'm going to kind of even come up the top of my tree going dab, dab, dab. We'll all remember this with Bob.
Okay, now.
And now I'm going to just use this brush dabbing up and down, and it's going to start talking about my tree. And I'm going to be like, oh, no, you have a little tree here. Oh, but your branches go out, and then, oh, it's out. Oh, tree. I gotta leave some trunk. I always forget to leave some trunk. And as we get down here, we're gonna get thicker because the forest has gotten thicker. Just pushing in. What the brush does is give me this sort of effect. Right? It's picking up what's underneath, and that gives me kind of a pine tree.
Yeah.
So I can pick up this green here, same load. I can come, you know, kind of here maybe, and then I can, I'm using the tip, can you see I'm using the edge here?
Yeah.
And dabbing down, and then I kind of switch to the fan, and I'm going back and forth dabbing. But a lot of this is still just understanding pine trees, right?
Mm-hmm.
If you've done other pine trees with me, now you're kind of seeing why I like my brights. I like to have a little more control over what's happening here. But there's nothing wrong with this. And if you were trying to do a very complicated landscape in oils in 30 minutes, man, this would be your friend. Right?
Mm-hmm.
This would be your guy. We would put in a whole bunch of trees. Look how fast this is putting in my trees. And I can come right on the edge. He used to come right on the edge. Remember that?
I do.
Come right on the edge. And where his trees would come to life is he'd come get a lighter color. Right?
Uh-huh.
And then he would come and might need some white to really pop that lighter color. Because I have black in there. So everything's getting great. But I'll show you the trick. There's a bunch of different ways of doing pine. There's also the one-stroke decorative way, which is super clever.
Yeah.
And then there's my way. And I'll show you all three. I'm just saying. So I'm just coming here and I'm just making sure that there's some highlights on this tree. What's showing up now? Oh, some pine is showing up, isn't it?
Yeah.
We're just getting a little pine tree. All right. That is one way of doing it. And, you know, it's always really fun to do this because then you can, and keep in mind, oils, like when we used to see Bob do them, are much more like soft-bodied. But I could sit there and, you know, use this to make some grass and bushes. And because the way that the thing is, it makes these kind of crazy little brush strokes. Not my fave, but not wrong either.
Now, have you ever used oil paint?
Yeah.
Huh. Would you consider teaching some oil painting?
No, not at this time. And the reason being is because I'm not proficient in it, and I think teachers should know what they're talking about.
True.
I think painters should just have a blast and do whatever they like and be crazy, but I think at the point you put out your teaching shingle, you ought to be informed enough to answer a question. And the honest truth is, while I know a bunch about oil painting as a painter and have had so many friends that painted oil, I spent years of my life thinking that oil painting was toxic.
Oh, yeah.
Which is not true.
No, it's really pretty natural.
The chemicals I was introduced to in oils, those were toxic. I was painting cheap products. And yes, there were terpenoids and there was all kinds of stuff. And it was very toxic. But Michael Harding, that is, other than like if you ate the lead paint, because he makes actual lead paint, that would be totally toxic. But, my goodness, the thinners, I have actually like considered, John knows this, they have this jug that's like $150. It's
the lavender.
Oh gosh.
I would just have
that in my house. I'd be rubbing it on my counters. And it's amazing. It's pressed, expeller pressed lavender.
Remember,
oil paints can be amazing, and they're not necessarily toxic, and they don't necessarily have fumes. And it's that kind of familiarity with the media. Like, I'm very comfortable in watercolor and pencil and a bunch of media. And I understand oils, and I understand how an oil painting is created, and I could probably get myself personally through an oil class. But I couldn't get you through an oil class. And that would be immoral of me to put out my oil teaching sink shingle and say, hey, come do oils with me. I took this up 2 minutes ago.
I remember, who sent us the little lavender bag that I have on my...
Oh, so incredible.
Who sent that? Do you remember? Was it?
But
was
if you want to know who to take oils with, I will tell you, because I know all the best teachers.
Yes.
And I'm happy to recommend. I do think you need somebody that's run into some... taught some students for a while so they're familiar with questions. That would be my thing. If you want to take up oils, they need to have taught some students for a while so they know how to answer questions, have a intimacy with the media.
Yeah.
So they understand all the pitfalls that can happen, and be even familiar with other experts in their field. Like if they're not ready to like answer maybe a particular question because that's not what they, you know, specialized in to be able to send you.
Sure.
Right, like right off the top of my head, you could take a Robert Warren workshop anytime and benefit from it.
Yeah.
Guy's the bomb.
Wilson
Bickford. The bomb.
I'm like attracted to the way that the oil paints kind of are made and the history of it. I was
it's fantastic.
Some of those companies.
This is
are
a
so
whole
amazing.
Soapbox okay, to get
so
me on.
But
I do know some good teachers, and I'm never offended if you guys are like, "Well, I really love you, but I really like oils." I'm always going to help you out.
And I will say thank you to, I'm not sure if it was Summer or Kim who sent us the lavender, but it's attached to my
fantastic.
Microphone, and I keep it right here all the time.
He does.
It's
so
actually,
true.
I love, so.
Okay, I'm going to show you guys another trick for pine.
Okay.
Now this one, I'm going to put out a little pine trunk with a brush, which is a number 4 bright.
Uh-huh.
I'm going to pull some just black paint onto it just for the purposes of being decorative. I might allow some white to get into it so it's not just a straight black line. And I'm going to come and create a trunk.
Oh, you're
see
fast.
My little trunk here?
Your trunk is so fast.
I'm sorry.
I'm just going to have to.
Sometimes I move at this speed because I'm
it's the paint speed.
It helps me actually
get
the paint off the brush.
I totally get it. I'm just trying to zip around.
And I apologize for that.
Oh, you don't need to. It's nausea cam.
And I have to tell y'all, I have just, in all honesty, when I saw the Michael Harding oils, I almost switched media.
Oh, those are so pretty.
Yeah, I was willing to take like a year
that lapis?
To learn that media. Because I saw colors in the Michael Harding oils my eyes had never seen before.
Yeah.
All right. So I've got my bright.
Speaking
and I'm going to come up here and I'm going to dab at the top. Dab, dab, dab. And this creates the top of my pine. As I start to come down, I'm going to thicken these little lines up. What I'm going to be doing is I'm dabbing. I'm going to be doing this upward and down motion on the corner of my brush. It is loaded to the halfway point, no further, in my bristles. And I will regularly be getting paint. But I'm going to start to wander out weird little impressions of branches that might be there. What I'm going to really be looking to do when I'm painting my little emotional pine is to not repeat a pattern. When I would say like that, it'd be like if I went like this. See how that stops looking natural real fast?
Uh-huh.
I'm repeating. They
look like little fluffy trees that you would take out of a box.
Don't make assembled Christmas trees. My mom likes to call it cloning. So to fix that, like if I do that, I'm going to wander this out. And see how the minute I wander it, it starts to feel more like a tree. I like to leave some of my tree kind of bald.
It's kind of...
He's survived some winters, a good fire.
Some personality.
All your trees should have personality. Straight up, all your trees should have personality.
They should talk with accents.
You know... and then maybe that goes like that. So the branches are kind of overall either kind of flat or up. And this kind of can change from pine to pine. And as you use pines for references, even if you do this kind of method to paint a tree, you still should pay attention to what's true about the tree.
Now, can you start, if you're new to trees, start at the bottom of the pine trees so you don't get them overly big and work your way up?
Yeah. I find when I start at the top and build out, it's easier for me, right? No. But then also, like, if I were left-handed, I might find that painting, like, at a downward angle might be easier for me than painting at an upward angle. See how that's almost not intuitive?
Uh-huh.
But downward is very comfortable. So there are things that sometimes, I don't normally paint left-handed, so just bear with me, that you might do... based on, like, this is me, and I know where I struggle. Yeah. And so, you know, it's great that the right-handed painters like to paint at an upward, you know, angle, but I need to paint at a downward angle to get the same effect. Never, never let yourself be stuck just, you know, to the purpose of, like, somebody does it this way.
Cool. Now, could I use a watercolor pencil to sketch in the shape, you know, the triangle first?
Yes, you could. And you can sketch it in. And maybe if you guys want, on Facebook Live on Friday, I can show you how to draw in and sketch in trees.
Oh,
the more you study a subject, the easier it gets to just sort of freehand it in when you're just messing around.
Yeah.
Right? Like, and then eventually you can do, like, imaginative landscapes. Like, that pink leaf, that was an imagination landscape. That's what I like to call an imagination landscape. I'm not really using a reference photo. I'm just sort of like, I feel like mountains look like this, and I feel like the snow is on them like this, and I feel like there should be some trees, and then I'm like, ooh, a lake would be pretty. And then I think, but somebody would live next to that lake because I would want to live next to that lake. And then I paint my little cabin in, and I think, but they would be home. So I turn the lights on inside the cabin. Imagination painting.
I don't know what you just said.
You do, because I talk to you about it as I'm doing it.
It's true. I'm along for the ride here.
You know.
Although I rather enjoy this.
So see how this is going, and then if I wanted to give this a highlight, I would just, you know, pick some more white up on my brush and then come here to the top of the branches, and then every once in a while say, oh, some light. I'm still coming from the left, like John suggested earlier.
Yeah, this is
and I'm pretending light is coming down from this angle and striking the tree on this side predominantly.
Now, other than interrupting you and distracting you with the community.
I love it. Anything you guys need?
No.
This is like y'all showed up for workshop and we're just talking. This is kind of like what we'd be doing. We're just talking about the nature of things.
This is a cool tree, by the way.
Oh, thank you.
I have to say, this is a bit of a darker tree.
I just
want to
give it a bush because it's bugging me.
It's a bit of a darker tree than the other trees.
This one?
Yeah.
Well, it's black.
It's a more ominous tree.
Oh, okay. Well, now I'm scrambling some bush and some abstract little landscape here. Look, and now it lives. Please put shadows under your trees.
Oh, yeah.
Please, right, like, be like, my tree has a shadow, and he lives right here, and he interferes with light, so he casts a shadow. Don't make an album, Sherpa, because you can't sing. Oh, I know. I know I can, but I don't care, because I'm happy today.
I'll make shadows
under my trees. But see how all of a sudden that feels like unified and like they live in a world where they break up light. I'm going to go through another sheet of paper.
I have a secret.
Oh, no, I'm out of paper. All right, I'm switching to my other pad.
I have a secret to tell Tim.
Huh?
I have to tell Tim a secret.
Hi, Tim.
See, we don't have to tell
Hi, Tim.
We don't have to tell your boss that you're here because your boss is here too.
Now, something to avoid with your trees. For many of you, and I probably should have started with this, so I apologize. I need to write these lectures. Many of you will do this for a tree.
Okay, hold on. Oh, yeah. The lollipop.
Right? This is your tree. And you're like, ah, has a tree. Right? But I want to point something out. And you'll go to an art class, and some very pretentious artist will tell you that this is the worst thing you've ever done in your life.
I like these trees.
And to never do it. But who saw Angela Anderson's new painting coming out?
I have not.
You have not. But I bet a bunch of you have. Is it not kind of lollipop trees? There isn't right or wrong in art. There is only intention. What are you intending to do? What's your goal? If your goal is to create a decorative abstract piece like it was Angela's, that was very emotional and whimsical and almost childlike.
And spoke to the feeling.
Yeah, and spoke with feeling. Her choices in that, when you look at that, of the way she constructed those trees, not as hyper-realistic trees, but as almost like pulled from the dreams of childhood and splashed on the canvas. I kind of like this painting. Sorry. What'd I do? You're moving the camera. I'm like, what'd I do? But I mean, it was like splashed on there. It was like so incredible. That was a choice that she made. She wanted to reach into you guys and elicit feelings of whimsy and delight and childhood and emotional depth. And if she had dipped into hyper realism, she might have lost that.
Yeah.
Intention is everything in art. Everything. Boy, this is the lesson where the people who've been saying, you're too chatty, shut up, are not happy. They're not still here, though. They came in, realized I was still talking.
We have over 280 people here.
280 people are like, I want to paint trees. I'm going to fiddle around with showing them a quick cherry branch.
Show them a quick cherry branch, because we have talked for sure today.
Well, we've got a little bit of stuff covered, and I know there's more to cover.
Oh, yeah, there is. There's curly.
I could sit there and do 6 months of trees daily on a daily paint talking to you about trees, and still have stuff to say at the end of that 6 months about trees. I'm not even kidding. No. We wouldn't even be out of conversation.
Just for 2 seconds before you go on, what okay. I will say is that we are absolutely catching all of these questions and comments about curly bark and flaky bark and the different kinds of trees. And
do we need a bark quest?
Yeah, Lisa's been capturing a lot of this. And when we
next week, do you guys want to do a bark? Well, I was going to do copyright.
Well, let's see. Before we
could do a bark quest. It's all good to me.
We may do the bark quest, but we'll definitely put together a dedicated video that's short, distilled, and to the point with all the stuff in it for you.
Well, I don't think we say all the stuff. We could say, a thing.
Some of this stuff.
Some of this stuff we could create. We didn't for this because John's like, is this going to be a short video? I'm like, no.
I was like, it's just branches. How long could we? I mean, how much do you have to say about branches? How long could we be here? Little did I know.
Little did he know.
Honestly.
He thought I was being all facetious and stuff.
And I'll say, guys, this is my favorite time to spend with you guys. I love running the cameras. It's my favorite part of the day. So thank you very much. Oh, good idea, Janine. She just said, can we paint a money tree?
Do you mean the one you buy at the Home Depot that's supposed to bring you good feng shui?
I think she meant
I haven't gone into bonsais. I really haven't studied bamboo. We haven't done any palms. And then there's all those weird, crazy trees that they got in Africa and
Middle
India.
Earth.
And then I haven't done the ones that have the moss coming off of them. And there's swamp trees and there's coastal trees. And then there's that.
There's the
Tory pine tree that's
There's Middle Earth.
Middle Earth
the
trees.
The Nine Kingdoms.
There's a lot of tree. And guess what I do intend to paint soon? And Flame already knows what I'm going to say. I intend to paint the elk crease. That's happening.
Tantween trees?
Elk crease.
Avatar trees.
Elk crease.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe a wampin willow.
Oh, yeah.
Let's see who in our community knows what I'm talking about. Oh. Maybe a wampin willow tree.
And maybe a little car in the wamp. A little. Let's see. That would be awesome.
That would be really fun, wouldn't it? Good. But that does that actually honor monsters and mythical creatures. I was like, maybe I needed to do a hippocampus for that or something.
That was a classic. I mean, anybody who's
adventurous.
I feel
like I got to do a fantastical beast.
Anybody
needs to have a whole month of fantastic.
Yeah, Whomping Willow, everybody's definitely in for the Whomping
Willow.
I love
the Whomping Willow with the car. I'm going to paint this cherry tree now.
Definitely bonsai. We definitely need some stores. Okay.
I've loaded my black paint on the tip of my brush like you do. And I'm going to do an interesting thing here. I'm going to bring my little cherry branch here, but I'm going to stir it out. I'm going to make a little knot.
What?
That little weird knot that I made. It's all uneveny, isn't it? And then I'm going to kind of really be rickety. Look how rickety I am here.
Ooh.
See how rickety this is?
Mm-hmm.
This is very, very rickety. What is really challenging about cherry blossoms is the way that they are really knotty and not badly behaved. I mean, there's knots and nonsense happening in the wood. Look at that.
Da-dun-dunch.
Da-dun-dunch. Right? And I'm literally I'm a press in and I'm almost shaking my brush and I'm bringing it down and I'm still kind of wiggling it and bringing it up. I'm lightening my pressure. Yep.
Yeah.
I could switch to a smaller bright, but I'm just going to hang in on this one. Pressing in here at this joint. And look, I curve back.
Yeah.
See how that starts to take on an absolute distinctive cherry branch feel. Right? I'm going to do one more like that where I'm pressing in. I'm wandering around and allowing it to get thicker and thinner. Okay? And then here's the interesting thing. I'm going to come off this knot and kind of make a little stroke and maybe a little more bouncy. Go ahead and pick up some gray if you need to. Lighten it up.
A mysterious fox thinks that thin branches are hard.
They are hard. Just pushing that in and letting it go. See, cherry branches are knotty, gnarly little bits of what the heck were you thinking? I'm going to even switch to a smaller bright.
A smaller bright?
I like the bright for this because it allows me to get unexpected thick and thin lines, which is super important for a cherry. You may want to do this with a detail. If you were to do it with a detail, let me switch to a detail.
Now, I like how you're kind of shaking your hand as you're making that because it makes it all feel twisted.
That is how I'm doing it. I'm just trying to make sure I am. See the little shake in my hand?
Yeah, and the jiggediness of your stroke.
Yeah, that's how I get it. That's how I get it. I absolutely. Some of you said I can't paint because my hand's shaking. Maybe a feature right now.
Mm-hmm.
Like, go with it. Be like, I got it. Cherry trees. See?
Yeah.
Now, if I add, I'm loading my little round up here to the tip like I do. And then if I go dab, 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 dab. I'm doing this all in black. It's going to look like a cherry tree in a minute. Dab, dab, dab. The reason that painting parties got so crazy about these trees is they lend themselves to these whimsical, delightful techniques. See, I'm just leaving the center open, and it looks like cherry blossoms. Are y'all, like, your mind's like, how is that in black paint? I am not connecting my flowers to the branch. Why am I doing that? Does anyone know? I'm going to come dab here. Make a nice 5-1. When they face you, they're 5 blossoms. When they're in a half, they're 3. Just little things that you might not know. Like that. This is a black on black cherry tree. What does it look like?
Cool.
It does. My little blossoms could float out. See? Cherry tree.
Very cool. Can you show me that little... I like how you make the little swirly... With a little, you know what I'm talking about—the little
whimsical trees. Whimsical trees are going to be your fluid paint and your detail rounds.
Oh, I didn't know I was opening a can there. I thought I was just saying that you could add some there to the.
Yeah, it's okay.
Okay, oh, I'm coming down.
So I'm going to do a little small because I'm running out of room on this paper. I'm going to plant my tree. Mm-hmm. I always like to say plant my tree when I press down hard. If you can see how I'm pressing down into the canvas, I'm going to come up, and I'm going to curl. I'm going to come up and I'm going to curl. Curl off here. Maybe curl off here. Curl off here. Connect this guy up because that went a little crazy on me. Just going to curl branches off of... I'm using everything that I previously learned about trees to make this whimsical, goofy tree. Look at that whimsical tree. I'm just being whimsical.
You're just informing some idea of the tree.
Well, yeah, that's all this is, isn't it? We're just playing.
But it seems like there's some rules to this. Like you're making the curlies can be consecutively smaller as they spin off. Like
well,
branches.
I'm playing all my tree things, aren't I?
Yeah.
Tree gets smaller as it gets up higher. Grows out further. Right?
Interesting.
You can have little leaves. Put leaves on it. You just do whatever you want. You could have a little curly branch coming over here. Things don't have to be hyper-realistic to feel like a tree. There's a lot of ways artists talk about trees because we all have that relationship to them.
Yeah, they really like the whimsical tree.
We could do a whimsical
tree. It seems like that would be very easy to do with kids.
It's easy to do with yourself. Sometimes you have to have your goof on.
Just sometimes to find it. Just, yeah. And like, you know, this would be great for anybody who's wind people.
Wind. It's fun stuff.
So thank you, guys.
I hope
love to
this
see your
cleared
branches.
Up some challenges that you've had. Did everyone feel more confident about their trees?
I think that there's a lot more. Yeah. There's a lot more tree questions, but I think that everybody here is really enjoying.
I'll just keep answering tree questions till you guys are like, I'm so sick of trees. Could you stop?
So they
let's do a rock or something.
Bark
drop
and
some
leave.
Water off a cliff. Anything. Give me a cloud. Anything. But this tree thing. Yeah. But you're not really going to get landscapes until you get trees down.
Yeah.
Right? And until you really get trees down. Not just decorative trees, but actual trees. So many of you guys send me pictures.
Mm-hmm.
Of what you'd like to paint, if you could paint anything. And I often think about what are the steps for you as a community between what your dreams and aspirations are as artists and what's currently going on. And I am, John knows, I'm very strategic in the lessons that I drop on YouTube to try to constantly introduce concepts that sort of build on other concepts like Legos so that we can get you to those landscape paintings that you guys keep sending me that is so deep in your heart to want to do. Because if I can give you guys anything, is to help you realize your art dreams.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I love, 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 love seeing all the paintings you guys do. Thank you so much for coming. And I think it was Kimmy in here who says, yes, I want to go paint right now. I just saw it scroll up here. I'm going to scroll up and see whoever that was. But thank you guys all for coming. We've had a huge room. We've had like almost, we've been so close to 300 people this entire time.
I'm glad. And you know, feel like you can ask questions on Facebook or on theartsherpa.com or on Twitter or on Instagram. Definitely practice some trees and meet me Friday on our Facebook Live and we'll draw some trees.
For sure. And maybe we'll do, they want to see bark and leaves next too.
Yeah. Next I can postpone copyright quest and then follow this up with bark and leaves.
Okay.
Because I think if we follow these up, if you guys don't mind, I know I made the announcement saying I was going to do the one thing, but if you guys don't mind pushing that off like another week.
Yeah.
We'll follow up with bark and leaves next week and keep building on these skills. I think by mid-fall, we will be ready. Everyone will be ready, no matter where you are in your art journey, for some of those landscape paintings that you're loving.
Oh, yeah.
Just say. I have to add some rocks in there and some other... some other things, but I think that we could, you know, talk clouds.
No, we got
good landscape.
We got some announcements. We got new good stuff coming for us. We're out on a couple peg stations. We got some new equipment coming.
Oh,
we're doing
yeah.
All sorts
if
of fun
you
stuff.
Want us on your peg station, you know, you can request it.
Yeah, talk to your local peg operator, and then all they have to do is either contact me and or any of the stations, and we'll coordinate getting the shows to them.
You can give our email out,
yep.
And they can have it up in days. And there might be stuff that's more on peg, you know, I hate, you know,
there
might
is
be peg,
some,
peg content.
There is some peg content coming.
So, could be good to have.
We love you guys.
I'm going to see you Saturday, all day. You know, you can come and go. We're going to paint Turner's Lighthouse. I just got to tell them this before we go.
Oh, yeah. Go ahead.
All right. We're going to paint Turner's Lighthouse. I hope to see every single body that's in the room right now at Turner's Lighthouse. It's going to be a long paint. I'm going to try to be done by the time Angela's on. I don't know if I'm going to make it because it's a bigger canvas. But we are going to do the drill down lesson. I'm going to film that Friday, and John's going to try to get that up of a 16 by 20. So I'm going to do it if I can get the canvas, the 32 by 40, to demo it. And my child's on the phone, so I got confused. I'm going to, you know, do the big canvas and show you how I change up my brushes for a bigger canvas. And I'm going to talk a little bit on that day and answer questions about working big. Because actually, my fine art, that's my comfort zone, is I like getting big. I feel so much more comfortable big. 16 by 20 is like my miniature canvas. But I'll do a 16 by 20. So if you want to do that Turner painting for yourself, that will be up, but if you're ready to do a big, big thing, I'm going to get this will probably be my smallest brush, my number 12 bright, for that big boy, and then I don't know what we're going to do with it because it's too big of a painting for the house. I don't know yep. what John's plan is for the giant painting.
So sorry, I'll just tell you, that was Leanne, that was me taking a phone call for you, so you know, I'm on some stuff, that's all it was.
oh, cool.
Yeah, that's all it was. I had a call coming in from our manufacturer, and I was like, I have to take this, so I have to make sure, because it's like, anyway, sorry guys, it's just little business.
You know, and just watch around, there's news, and there's things, and there's stuff afoot, and I love the suggestions for art, we're doing everything that you guys are asking.
Shop.theartsherpa.com.
Oh yeah, for shirts and stuff.
To shirts and t-shirts and...
zombie shirts now.
And mugs. All sorts of fun stuff.
I know I held you up all today. Thank you so much for your time and energy and patronage. It's so appreciated. You guys are the best, literally.
We love you guys.
And see you at the easel really soon.